This is a rocket-powered golf club. Professional golfers have an average swing speed of 110 miles per hour, but using two F-size motors, she swings at 150 miles per hour every time. Usually for builds on my channel, I just show you guys the final thing and don't really talk about the process of how we got there. And rest assured, today we will get to see huge drives, whoa! Golf balls shattering glass in super slow-mo, pulverized watermelons, and even a handheld version. But this build, I think, is a great chance to pull back the curtain and demonstrate how the engineering design process actually works. I want to highlight six learning opportunities that led us to this final design. And to do that, we need to go back in time 4 months to when I first had the idea. And as always, we started with a simple prototype to see if the concept even had a remote chance of working. But before we fire it up, you'll notice we have counterweights on the opposite side here. That's so that the center of mass of the spinning part is on top of the axis of rotation. In other words, it balances perfectly at the point at which it spins around. If you don't do that for something that spins, it creates a bunch of extra force for your system to deal with. It starts as a small vibration, but then it gets worse and worse as you pick up speed. Since we need to hit this tiny ball with the head of this club at really high speeds, if we're not perfectly balanced, the club and the whole platform itself would just be shaking all over the place and we'd never hit it. Okay, back to the test. Those stands are shaking more than they should, so we knew we would need to balance the spinning part better for the real test, but at least we knew it could go kinda fast and nothing blows up. And so then it was time for CAD, which is always the next step. And then together with my friends Ken and Kayla, we started cutting metal and making stuff. Things came together well, so we epoxied a 3D printed motor mount to the top of the driver and prepped our first real test by taking one of those easy ups and draping some nets on the side for safety, just in case something went catastrophically wrong. This was our second learning experience. We didn't have enough contact area for epoxying the head to the driver, so it wasn't a strong enough bond. This was tricky because it meant we had to 3D scan the club head, which allowed us to CAD up and then 3D print a more contoured mount with more contact area for the epoxy. We also took this chance to double the rocket holsters because what could possibly go wrong? So we went to test our new dual rocket setup with two E motors and everything went perfectly. Except for the part where the head snapped off the driver. And when we reviewed the slow-mo footage, what we realized was the shaft of the driver is so flexible that it would start to bend and then create really weird thrust vectors for the rockets, which then just bent the shaft even more. This is not what you want to see. Eventually, this exceeded the stress limit of the shaft and the head just came off. So our third learning opportunity was to stiffen up the club shaft. So we got some aluminum C-channel and just dumped a butt ton of epoxy in there, and this worked remarkably well. You could see the difference here. And so with that, we headed out to a very remote shooting location in beautiful Northern California. So we finally arrived and started to set up, but first, I had something I wanted to get off my chest. So one of the things I like most about me is that I like to reach out to lesser known channels and sort of give them a handout and some exposure on my channel, which is why today I'm here with Destin, Smarter Every Day. And if by some miracle you don't know, Destin is on the Mount Rushmore of science YouTubers. We've been friends for almost exactly 6 years, and I know this because I took a screenshot of the huge moment for me when he subscribed to my channel when I only had 10,000 subs. He's made videos about the physics of cats landing on their feet, tattoos in super slow-mo, or the first video I saw of him about how chickens have an internal open feedback loop which allows them to head track. If you've never seen his stuff, I'm actually jealous because you have so many hours of high quality viewing in your near future. So, I like golf.
I like rockets.
Should we do this?
Yeah, it's just, that was the intro, right? Whatever.
So we all continued to set up, and something that was important to me was for this to look as natural as possible at a driving range. So we added some turf to cover the base plate, and then dissected a golf bag to cover the sturdy steel column. And then if you add some clubs, it looks pretty awesome. It's incredibly rigid, and yet it can still swing freely. Our fourth learning experience came from reviewing our final test footage. If you listen, the club goes faster and faster with each rotation. Naturally, we want the club to contact the ball when it's going the fastest, which in our case is 10 rotations in 1 second. That means we somehow need to sneak the ball into the path of the driver in less than a tenth of a second, or a quarter of an eye blink. To accomplish this, we have a pneumatic cylinder here that hinges up the tee. It knows when to fire because on the back of the shaft there's a light sensor, and this disc has a slit which allows the light to pass through once per rotation. So we send that info to an Arduino over here that counts for us, and then after 15 rotations, it tells the cylinder the precise moment to fire using a solenoid. And then we super glue the ball to the tee because it provides the Goldilocks amount of force to first secure and then release the ball. Plus, the super glue looks super dope in slow-mo. So now with everything in place, we started with two e-motors, which as a reminder is the same setup that ripped the club head off.
3, 2, 1, roll!
Where did it go? What happened?
Go!
No way!
That's a cool shot right there, dude.
Dude, this is respectable. Like, this is legit.
After reviewing more of the high-speed footage, we noticed something interesting.
The sound effect there is like, doing, oing, oing.
This was an interesting technical observation from Destin, and that tee flexibility was causing us to hit some bad shots like this. An obvious fix is just to make the tee more rigid so that it doesn't over-rotate when it pops up. But there's a problem with this. There's a saying that force follows stiffness, and for us, a really stiff tee would transfer a bunch of force and destroy our nice 3D printed pop-up mechanism. Now imagine this crumpled up piece of paper as the tee, which is obviously way less stiff. Our flexible rubber tee was great because it acted like this piece of paper. No matter how hard you hit it, the force doesn't get translated down and damage our hardware. So Kent had the brilliant idea of just tying a string to the tee and staking it into the ground. This stopped the over-rotation, but everything was still just as flexible.
When the string pulls tight, does it make the ball fly off because it doesn't doink enough?
The only way to test is a doink test.
2, 1.
Ah, beautiful.
There was some doinkage.
I just thought this was a really simple, clever idea that solved both problems at once, and as you can see, it worked perfectly. Now we're ready to try a dual F motor. So these deliver about twice as much force to the club as the E motors that made the head snap off. And this provided our final and certainly most poignant learning opportunity.
3, 2, 1, go!
Where's the club? Is the tree on fire?
Wow. Like, I'm laughing, but that could have been bad. There we go. This thing was like suborbital, dude. So we have 3 U-bolts and we only use 2.
Yeah.
So I think we'll just max out those and just crank them way down now that we know this is a failure point.
Now that we know this is a failure point, there's several failure points, and I hear you say, oh, we have a solution for that.
This is the engineering design process.
It's rather fun.
Like I mentioned, the clip that failed was cut too short and therefore only attached using two U-bolts, which we thought would have been enough to support the 800-pound load from centrifugal force. We did notice the rubber handle was worn due to so many test fires, which probably initiated the stress concentration leading to the failure. So our fix was to cut the next club longer so we could use three U-bolts and really crank them down on a fresh rubber handle. And so with all six of our learnings now in place, we tried the insane double F motors one more time.
Go! Like, the rush you get from, like, an engineering achievement actually working is, like...
Seriously, dude.
Oh! Oh! Oh, look at the flames! Oh, wow. Yeah!
So we never found these long balls to measure the exact distance, but I can drive a ball 280 yards, and these were well beyond that. I mean, just look at this trajectory, straight to outer space. Now that we got all the shots we needed, it was time to have some real fun. We started with a handheld version that was powered by a single C motor, because anything more than that would just be way too unsafe for me to hold.
Oh, like 300 yards, man! It really did, like, make it so much easier to swing. I'm not even kidding. Yeah. Like, it really made a difference. Three, two,
and then some glass, just because. And then, keeping with the tradition of my channel, some watermelon.
Cutting open a watermelon with a rocket powered golf club, Mark.
You're welcome. Yeah, that's all of this. The past 3 months of work in engineering was just to enjoy,
boils down to this moment.
Just to enjoy this watermelon.
Yeah, Mark's like trying to make stuff look good. We're not wasting food though.
We waste no part of the engineering effort, like the great Indians with the buffalo.
So Destin made a video on his channel about why some balls bounce high and others don't. And my first thought was, well, that's easy. It just has to do with how compressible or rubbery it is. Yet this billiard ball is pretty much completely solid, and this bouncy ball is pretty rubbery, and yet they bounce to pretty much the same height. So it's something else. And as you can imagine, this is a pretty important piece of information for golf ball makers. So he has lots of amazing slow-mo footage of golf balls being squished in ways that hurt your brain, plus way more footage from today's shoot, so I will leave a link in the video description. And while you're there, make sure to check out some of his other videos and subscribe to his channel, because he's just a classy individual and a true professional in every sense of the word.
Are you rolling?
Yeah.
Hey, it's me, Mark.